I'm Rowan Rheingans, and I am a musician and composer and theatre maker. And I live in Sheffield, in the northern parts of England. And I'm 33 years old, and I've called myself a professional musician full time for probably 8 years now. And I feel like I've got here mostly by following my nose. It wasn't clear to me really until a few years ago that this was going to be my vocation and this was going to be my job. So I wasn't someone that always had this idea that being a full-time professional musician was going to be the best thing for me. So I have meandered to this point, and I think all my meanderings have also been important in the way that I do my job. So I was very lucky to grow up in a musical family. So I suppose in the very early months and years of my life, music was always around. Both my parents are musicians, folk musicians. So my mother was playing concertina and saxophone around the time that I was born, and singing a lot. And then later on, she began playing the fiddle as me and my sister also picked up the fiddle. And my dad is a 5-string banjo player. And now I'm a singer, a fiddle player, and a banjoist. So I can't deny that my upbringing has been probably the most important part of my first inspiration into music. I think also the wider context of folk music is important, because folk and traditional music is social music. So outside of the family, lots of people aren't introduced to folk music in the family. But the next place that you might encounter it is maybe in a pub session, maybe in a community setting, maybe at a festival, maybe in the street. There was Morris dancing in my street yesterday. So folk music is kind of, it is in communities, and I was very lucky to be immediately introduced to that. So my dad is also a fiddle maker, and had his stall at lots of folk festivals. So we would all go when he was selling his instruments at the festivals. So in the very beginning, I knew that music was a central part of my life. It was a way that I made friends. It was the way that I experienced joy. So ceilidh dancing, social occasions, really. So, and then that thread has really carried on. I've taken that into lots of different contexts, but at the kind of initial inspiration of it is that I was lucky enough to be introduced to it through my family. I try to listen to a lot of different kinds of music. There was something I remember my music teacher, when I was doing A-level music, saying to me, was just listen to as much different kinds of music as you can. And I still think I do that. So I listen to a lot of folk music, but I listen to jazz, I listen to classical music. I've listened to a lot of indie and singer-songwriter music in the last bit of time. I seem to go down rabbit holes with music and get very interested in a certain kind, and then think, okay, I've been here for a while now, I'll put my ear somewhere different. And I think things like radio shows actually are very important to me for discovering new music. So not necessarily the algorithmic thing of like Spotify, which maybe answers the question about how music might be changing. But I think radio shows are really amazing because, like, when you trust a show, so I'm a big fan of like late night Radio 3 shows, like Night Tracks or Late Junction or Music Planet, or maybe on Six Music, like Keris Matthews on a Sunday, you lend your ear to someone else's curation, and that'll usually be a bit of a starting point for what I then listen to. You know, there's some Afrobeat, I don't listen to enough of that, I'll go down a rabbit hole and see what I find. So I think I try to keep my ears open as much as possible. And it's also, I think, like, important to listen to music that you don't like, that isn't something that feels really familiar. That's something that I try to do. It can be hard to remember to do that, but I think that's always going to inspire you as well, is to understand, you know, is to listen to stuff that is actually not sitting comfortably, or it's not something that you love. The music that excites me, I think, depends on where I'm at on a given day or in a period of time. When I hear something that I feel resonates, I feel like that's exciting. But I think that can happen in lots of different ways. So it's not always the same genre or the same style or the same something, but it might just be like an ingredient that I hear. And I think that might sound a bit vague, but it's music's ability to communicate and reach out that is also what I want to be like as a musician. You know, I want my music to lean forward and reach out in a concert setting or on a recording. And so when I hear other music doing that for me, my ears kind of prick up and I'm excited. And then I might wonder, you know, what is it? What is that ingredient that they're doing there? And how do I think music is changing? It's a really interesting question, because I think that question can be put in two different ways. It might refer to the music industry, it might refer to the job that I do, which I think is changing massively at the moment. And then it's interesting to ask that to a folk musician, because actually the raw ingredients of the music that I make have kind of been constantly changing forever, and also in that kind of staying the same, if that makes sense. So folk music has always been shaped by whoever is playing it at any given time. So as human beings change and live in different contexts and different countries and different languages, the folk music will reflect that. So in a way it's constantly changing, but in a way it's also always of people. And that's what I find so beautiful about folk music, is that I can also kind of connect with people hundreds of years ago who were playing this kind of music because it felt nice to dance this kind of dance to. And that makes sense to me, even though our lives are so different now. And how the industry is changing is something that I'm navigating, as I think most musicians are at the moment. I think that the last few years especially, or maybe the last decade really, has been a time of massive shifts in how we listen to music. Even like in my career, at the very beginning of starting out doing gigs, maybe about 10 years ago, you know, we'd get, you know, 2,000 or 3,000 albums ready for a tour, and everyone would buy CDs. And obviously now it's quite a different thing, just people don't have CD players anymore. It's a very practical way that that's shifted, but it also has it has implications for how people are listening. You know, is an album even relevant anymore? It's a big question. You know, 10, 12 tracks in a certain order, maybe it doesn't feel as relevant as it once did. So I feel like I don't know the answers really of how it's shifting and changing, but I know that all of us are navigating those changes and trying to work out how to keep something sacred about music in the center of it. So just one element, one small element of a big wider discussion is like about streaming, and it's going on a lot at the moment about, you know, how do we survive as music makers when our music now is expected to be consume for free. And just the discussion about what music is actually, what being a professional musician is kind of up for discussion. I think that can be an exciting thing as well as a very challenging thing. I feel like I've been inspired and my career has been influenced and touched by so many people. I would say that everybody I've collaborated with or been in a band with or made a record with has had an imprint on my work that comes after that. And I think that's, maybe it's an obvious thing to reflect on, but I've been very lucky to have quite long-standing professional working relationships. So the trio that I perform with most, we've been singing together now for over 12 years. So I can really track, you know, how my own understanding of my voice and my songwriting is absolutely part of that journey with that band. So other musicians, I'd say, are always my main influence. And then I suppose specifically, teachers that I've had over the years. And I would say also that I'm still becoming a musician. You know, so even though I work full time at this, I'm successful, it's going well, I'm also always looking forward to meeting the next person that's going to teach me something. And I think that that never ever should end, and I don't plan on stopping that journeying. So back when I was 19, I studied in Sweden for a year. I studied Swedish traditional fiddle playing. And I had two teachers, Olof Miskeld and Jonas Brandin, and they were, at that point in my playing life, very, very integral and inspiring teachers, both quite different, both with different voicings of the fiddle, but also completely different teaching methods. And as a teacher now, I can also really hear myself channeling what I was taught back then from those teachers. So I'd count those as very important people. I think also I'm very inspired by artists outside of music. And I really feel when I'm composing or performing, I feel the influence of writers and poets, novelists and artists that I love coming in. And I would say that that's also something I would really encourage students of music to do, is to not see music as a blocked off little cave where you only get to be inspired by other musicians or other music teachers. I feel like some of my best work has been inspired by writers who are speaking to me in a way that makes me then want to translate or respond in music. The world makes music. You know, everybody in the world on some level engages with music. So, you know, and I know this especially, I think, from being brought up in folk music. And there's something about the knowledge that every country in every part of the world has, even if it's not known to most people, there are songs and tunes there that are anonymous. So they're not composed by anyone. They are just there. And they're only there if someone keeps singing them, and then they die out, and that's okay. But that there exists. So my upbringing in folk music and my knowledge of folk music now has given me this idea that music, it kind of exists in the air between people everywhere. So there's something very comforting and kind of unifying about that feeling. And you know, I have, it's an idea as well as like a practical experience of mine, that when you travel somewhere, if you're lucky enough to travel somewhere far away from your home, and you don't speak the language, and maybe the culture is unfamiliar, music is a communication. You know, it's a way of communicating something very fundamental, whether it's a dance tune or a song that just communicates the sound of your voice that you can join with another voice. It doesn't matter if you don't know the same language. So there's something very unifying about the fact that it seems to be a very human instinct to create music. I find that in this, you know, in the context of so many unhumane things going on in the world, I find that a very comforting thing, that music seems to persist despite everything. And what it means to me personally is similar, really. It's like a constant, you know? So even if it isn't my job, or even if, you know, all the gigs go away again, like they did in the pandemic, I still played my fiddle. I still made sounds that filled my day with some beauty, and I still listened to other people and tried to, you know, invite people to share music. For me personally, it's a constant in my life that it's just a little bit above or a little bit beyond the everyday existence, you know. So I feel like it's a way to access a kind of emotional plane that is not quite accessible, maybe in words. You know, words feel very limited once you have the possibility of music as well. So that's how it plays out in my daily life. So the word folk is so widely used. You know, I could describe a crackly archive recording of a singer captured in the 50s, you know, somewhere anonymous as folk music, and then Mumford and Sons is folk music, and Bob Dylan is folk music, and then something from, you know, Bulgaria, a big choir, is folk music. So it's a word that I actually tend not to use myself, unless I can make clear that the term, I think, is quite contested. I think it's usually used in a good way to kind of describe a music that is of the people and therefore can be co-owned. And I think that's a good description of what I mean by folk music. And I think that it's not always what is meant, if you see what I mean. So, you know, like singers like Laura Marling, who I love and I listen to a lot, her songs are hers, they are hers. And when you sing them, you're singing a Laura Marling song, and that's fine. But I wouldn't call it folk music because the singer can't fully own that song. Whereas the tunes and the songs that I sometimes inhabit that are traditional music, is sometimes another way of putting it, they are, they're ownable, you know, so you can become the custodian of the song. And it's speaking about an experience that you can fully inhabit rather than someone's specific breakup or something like that. So I think that's one way of understanding what folk music is. But I'm also, I love kind of throwing into the air genre definitions, because you can always find an exception and you can always find but what about this? And I think that's fine, I think that's good. And if there's one thing I think that's also very true about folk music or traditional music, is that it's always changing. It's always being adapted. It's always being made up, actually, which is also very important to remember. There's nothing unbreakable or like perfect about any version of a song or a tune in folk music. You know, if I pick up an old tune and I change a few notes, or I pick up an old song and I want to add a verse, I'm only doing what everybody else has already done with it, you know? And my version is also only one version of many. So there's a malleability and a shifting changeability that is also, I think, really part of the definition of this kind of music. it needs to be able to be taken apart and put back together again in the way that it always has been. I think if you're thinking about studying music or thinking that a career in music might be interesting to you, I think great, hold on to that feeling and that interest. Most of all, don't forget why you're interested in music. There are so many ways to have a career in music. So I would also really advise to think widely, to investigate what might be possible. There's not only one path, and there's not only one right path either. And it could be that, you know, it's something that crops up again later in life, or it could be something that you follow straight out of school, whatever. Keep an open mind. And I would say, yeah, most of all, I'd say don't rush. And to try and keep music itself central. I think that's the way that you're going to have a meaningful career in music, is if you keep what's actually important musically to you central, if you can. And yeah, I'd say speak to and ask as many questions to other musicians or teachers or people that you respect. Ask about their career path or their study and try and find out what other people have done, especially people that might have done something that you hadn't considered before. I think that's something I did, was just have as many conversations as I could with other musicians. You know, what did you do? How did you get here? There'll be so many ways to, there'll be so many paths to take, and they'll all lead somewhere different. So I would say keep an open mind, keep music central. Personally, for you, keep music alive in its actual sense. So don't get too bogged down with making a career of it if it means that you forget why you love music for its own sake, and talk to as many people as you can about if they're doing something that you might be interested in. Ask them how they got there. There shouldn't be any reason why you couldn't follow the same path.